gain that complexity advantage as well. Now, this is kind of the brief overview, forgive the cheesy animation, but this is how we find a target. So we find this initial space called the search volume, and it's basically the set of points, and of course it's a continuous region, but here quantized for illustrative purposes. It's the set of points that are formed by the intersection of these two beam widths. And so very clearly you can see that it's defined by the look direction of the beacons, the beam width, and the number of beacons that are intersecting. And now we can take that information and we can add it to the phase difference of arrival information that we recover from this RE payload, that common beam frequency envelope. And so you can see kind of the first part, this is just the simple line intersection equation where these speeds represent the range of frequencies that are found in the beam width, or sorry, the range of angles that are found in the beam width. And here, this is the phase difference of arrival equation. This is basically the hyperbolas that I showed you earlier from the phase difference gradient. And unfortunately, this doesn't have a deep closed form solution, but you can solve it iteratively using a technique like Newton-Raphson or your favorite iterative solver of choice. And this is kind of what it looks like. So here's, of course, a very simple simulation. And you can see that this is our initial search volume. This is where we would estimate the target to be based on angle of arrival. And this is where the actual target is. And this yellow region is the region we were able to find by fusing the angle of arrival information with the phase differencing. OK, so that said, we're now going to make two interesting modifications to the system, which we originally considered to dismiss, thinking, oh, there's nothing useful here. But we later found out there was. So we make two changes. The first is, instead of having the transmitters illuminate the target from widely different angles, we're going to move the transmitters very close together, such that they're looking at the target from almost the same angle. And the second thing we're going to do is, instead of transmitting continuously, we're going to transmit in pulses. This allows us to capture time of flight information. And two very interesting, and I think at this point everyone's going to see kind of where this is going, these are the hyperbolic phase difference lines, and these are the radial time of flight lines. Now, if you look at these two sets of isolated lines, you realize that if we put them on top of each other, they form a very nice grid, which allows us to instantaneously, since we can recover both of these pieces of information simultaneously from a single pulse, find any set of combinations in this space. So here's how we envision it might work. you can see, again, forgive my PowerPoint skills and clip art. But you can see that we envision taking the two transmitters, which before we were thinking of two separate blocks, and considering them as two separate modules on one piece of equipment, which we now call a ground station or a station. So here is our original transmitter A, our transmitter B. Just like before, they're transmitting pairs of unique frequencies with a common spacing. And I've kind of separated them out here for illustration purposes. Here would be what I call channel B and channel A. And then those pulses are going to go out. They're going to travel out here. They're going to reflect off some targets and come back to any number of receivers. And at those receivers, you're going to see two pieces of information. You're going to see an overall time of flight, which comes from the very loose time sync between the transmitter and receiver. And then you're going to use this phase differencing to get a very fine, essentially, time difference, right? That's what we call phase difference at a common frequency. And you can see that we get a positive, negative, and zero. Again, we can differentiate because we have unique identities. And that allows us to create this entire system. Now, there's an interesting design points to consider here. The first thing is the separation. Now, separation is going to impact coverage. So by bringing these two transmitters close together, this is by separation, talking about this distance, the width between these here. When you bring them very close together, you're going to reduce the volume that you cover before your phases are no longer unambiguous, meaning you're going to roll over in that 180-degree space. And when you bring them further apart, you're going to be able to cover wider areas. Now, that phase difference is constant. We only have 180 degrees. So if we spread that spacing out, we're going to lose target resolution. And that's exactly what happens. So you can see here kind of that other effect. Now, to explain this picture, okay, so I'm running a little ahead of my schedule, I guess. I'm just so excited to be here with you guys. Okay, so you can see here in this picture, this is a simulation. This is a target located 50 kilometers out from the radar system along the bore site, which is where the angular resolution is at its minimum performance. It's somewhat of a worst case. And you can see this light blue region is our phase difference hyperbolic. So that's the region of uncertainty for which the phase value we detected, including the system noise, would limit the target to, so somewhere in this blue band. This yellow band is the time difference of arrival band, as seen by a ground station that's located somewhere to the southwest, meaning the line of sight between that ground station and this target would be orthogonal to this yellow band. And the intersection of these two regions gives us the region of likelihood for this target. And the average radius of this region is plotted here versus the transmitter separation. So as we're increasing our coverage area, which in effect has the effect of increasing our speed at finding broad target clusters in space, we have the converse effect of decreasing target uncertainty. Now, what's interesting to note here is that this is of course nonlinear, and so there's kind of like an optimal move spacing somewhere around here. Now, this was done with a frequency difference of 20 megahertz, and using the model that we presented in the Milcom work with some just commercially available and expected values for estimating, you know, the capabilities in terms of, you know, clock drift and clock oscillator stability. And with that, I will take any questions. And I'm a little bit ahead of time here, but I'm sure we'll all appreciate some extra moments to sleep or check email.
Is it off? Shut up, your camera
going off? Oh, that's okay. I think I'll have to learn how to do some video editing.
Quick question. Your last chart there, unless I'm missing something, how did you get the two transmitter separations less than the lambda?
Okay, no. It's not. So the interesting thing, I meant to mention this, but I skipped over it. So the unique thing about the RA encoding is that the frequencies that we actually transmit, the electromagnetic frequencies, and the frequencies we're using for this target differentiation, this localization, are independent. Because this localization comes from a frequency difference. Right? So we're able to space the transmitters close together, and, you know, which are still many, many wavelengths apart from a, you know, an X-band perspective. Yet, you know, the frequency differences.
So that's not the R equivalent that you're seeing here?
No, that's the frequency, that's the F common, the frequency
that's
difference.
The wavelength of the difference.
Wavelength of the difference.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.